you all hear me?
Hello?
Yes, no?
Yes.
Yes, great. Welcome, thanks for coming out. My name's Nathan McIntyre, for those of you I don't know. Data engineer here at Ibotta. And tonight, we're here to talk to you about how Ibotta has scaled from using a kind of traditional data warehouse towards using the data lake. Okay, so for the agenda, tell you a little bit about Ibotta so you can get an idea of the kind of data that we have and the kind of work that we're doing. Then kind of take you through the history of our growth and some of the challenges we've met along the way and those that we've solved and those that we haven't. The data vision, so what we're actually trying to do here at Ibotta with the data team, the data lake. After that, I'm going to turn it over to Charlie and Heather to kind of give you guys an idea of what Ibotta Lytics, our analytics team, is doing with the data lake. And then we'll wrap it up and have some time for some Q&A. So, but feel free to interrupt me if you have any questions during the talk. If it gets out of control, we can take it offline, but yeah, cool. So, about Ibotta. So, it probably give you an idea of the data that Ibotta has. So you might know that we're the app that gives you cash back on everyday purchases. But a little bit more than that, we've had in the past 5 years, over 22 million downloads. We've also established ourselves as the third most used shopping app. So that means when it comes to people using their smartphones and shopping online, the only place that they stay longer is eBay and Amazon. Our users spend over $5 billion annually, and of that, we process a little over 12 million redemptions per month. Now, that's really just to give you an idea of the kind of data that we're processing and how much we have. We've also established ourselves as the number one leader in purchase attribution space. So what that means is with the app, we can track what a consumer actually does from the time that they see an ad to whether they actually end up buying something, which puts us in a unique position that most advertisers can't do. And finally, we're not just a company that collects purchase data on people, we actually give back. So up until this point, we've given back over $200 million to our users, and we're closing in on 250. So what about the data that we have? Well, it's, as you might imagine with purchase data, it's very rich, and there's a lot that you can do with it. Because our users, when they use the app, they scan their receipts, we actually have data on the entire item level data on their entire basket. So it's not just information on the products that we advertise or have redemptions for, it's the full list. On top of that, because it is a mobile app, we have access to the geolocation data. So where a person is when they actually buy something or when they walk past the store, which they have the opportunity to buy and they don't. And also we have demographic data. So when people sign up, they give us some basic information, and as part of the incentive process, we often have things like questionnaires or surveys that you have to answer to unlock, and we collect all of that data. So some growths and challenges, the history of Ibotta. So we began about 5 years ago. I think the company was probably what you might expect from a startup. Pretty basic. Backend was a transactional database, kind of comes out of the structure of the app. Pretty traditional. Analytics at the time was really a manual process. So in order to give our customers information on their campaigns, it was really like a custom process. People would build custom Excel spreadsheets. It wasn't real time, it was a batch process. It took a lot of effort. But it did work for the time. And as the company grew, we automated things a little bit, but obviously this is something that you can stay for much time. So our first attempt at scaling was, of course, the AWS route. We've been an AWS shop since day one, so this is kind of a natural solution for us. So we started out with Redshift, which is kind of Amazon's de facto big data solution for traditional type of database. Started moving, automating things with data pipeline. Started using Looker, so it was no longer a manual process. We could give people dashboards and reports on how their campaigns are doing in real time. And again, for the time, this did work. But it soon didn't fit what we were trying to do. So since we picked Redshift as our data warehouse, it quickly became the place where everyone would just dump data. So while it was probably first supposed to support the reporting, it's now anytime anyone needs to do some analysis, so let's just go dump the data into Redshift. One of the big problems with that is that compute and storage are coupled with Redshift. So that means if you're going to use it as a data warehouse, and you start sticking data in it, more and more data, you may still be processing the same amount, so you have the same compute needs, but now you have to pay for storage. And there also is a cap on how much you can scale a Redshift cluster. So I think Redshift does have a use case if it's used wisely, but it can't be your end-all, be-all data solution, as we quickly found. So to help solve that scaling problem, we decided on, we need to move away from this and establish a data lake. Why a data lake? Well, because you can't use Redshift to stick everything in there, right? It doesn't work, right? And as I alluded to before, a big piece for us was the coupling, or the actually decoupling of storage and compute that you can get with the data lake design. Since we always have been an AWS shop, it made total sense for us to start using S3 as our back-end storage. With that too, we've always been a cloud business. So the idea of using things like ephemeral clusters also made sense to us, especially some of the people that started here in data science and data engineering. We had some experience in this, and so it was a natural solution to us. There's also plenty of other reasons to use a data lake, depending on your use case, and we can talk about that later. But I mean, it really comes down to that for us. So, some growing pains. This wasn't just something we did overnight. Ran into a lot of problems. A lot of those problems, I think we've done a good job at solving. A lot of them we're still working on, and others we still don't know. One of the big issues we ran into was building a new plane while trying to fix the old one that keeps breaking. So couldn't just transition to a database or a data lake overnight, just dump all of our data into S3 and continue as business as usual. So many things are still coupled with Redshift. So in addition to trying to scale out this new infrastructure and these new teams, we do still have to support Redshift. How have we handled that? It's been an iterative process, and it's been setting the expectation that kind of migration is going to take time, and it's still a work in progress. Another challenge to be aware of in trying to do this yourself is training for a new tool set. Not everyone has experience with Hadoop and Presto and Spark, and while you can make the transition, it's not something that's necessarily easy for people who have been working for years with a traditional database. When it comes to Presto and Hive, there's things you just don't have to deal with when it comes to something that's managed like Redshift. And because of that, there can be some internal resistance for people wanting to move on to a new system. Like, if I'm working with Redshift and it works for me, why should I move? To get around this, we've done a lot of internal training and support. So for instance, one of the things that we found really useful was setting up a Slack channel. specifically to handle like query support for people trying to move from Redshift over to Presto, you know, because they would take their queries from here, which ran fine, try and run them on Presto, and they wouldn't get the same results. So those of us with some experience could go to that Slack channel and help them out, and people can search the history. So that's made a huge difference for us. Another problem with growing this out is scaling the organization and meet supply and demand. So as a data engineer here at Ibotta, data engineering is kind of overwhelmed by our Vitalytics department. So you have, you know, a ton of people, yeah, you guys. You got a ton of people saying, you know, give me this data, I got stuff to do, and you only have so many people producing it. It could be the other way around, right? Like a huge data engineering department producing all this stuff and no one around to do it. So that is a little bit of a challenge, is kind of balancing those out. And it's not an easy thing to solve, right? So how do you solve that? That's with hiring, and that's not something you can just do overnight or automatically. But it's still something that we're working with today, but I think we've done a pretty good job. And lastly, point to bring up is having moving to a new infrastructure like this, a data lake infrastructure away from something managed like Redshift, is the need for, you know, an ops team. So at Ibotta, we don't have one of your standard fixed operations team, and our dev ops resources are pretty small. But in growing out our data lake solution, we went with Qbol, which really solved this problem for us. So for those of you that don't know about Qbol, it's a kind of big data platform as a service company. So instead of using EMR, we use Qbol, and they manage spinning up the clusters in AWS, scaling them, spinning them down, we're not using it. It gives the ability to launch many clusters at a time of different sizes, running Spark, running Hive. So we're not confined to having, you know, an on-prem cluster that just runs Hive at a certain version, and it's a huge pain to get it upgraded. We can spin up as many as we want, as many as we're willing to pay for. So, I kind of want to introduce Qbol, since we're going to be talking about it later on in this talk. The really nice thing about Qbol, on top of managing all of this and providing the support that normally would have been handled by a DevOps team, is the UI that they have. Everything is integrated in one spot. So you go to one place to manage your clusters. And I think manage is actually a little bit of an exaggeration, because there's not much to it. It's also the same place that you go to access all of your data. Other benefits are the ability, so because we let Qbol manage the scaling of our clusters, we also have the ability to specify using spot instances rather than just everything on demand, and we can tune that. That saves us a lot of money. You can see we're going pretty close. What is that? Okay. So the data vision at Ibotta. So moving, as we started 2017, we realized that we had a rich set of data, and there's a lot of interesting products we could build out of it. So we have the data, and we have a vision of what we can do with it. More machine learning, more predictive analytics, less of just reporting on things after they happen. Putting back value into the app, so like recommendation systems, personalization. In order to do that, though, we first needed to scale the organization. So we realized that, one, we need a data engineering team, simply because we didn't have one. We had regular engineering people producing data, and then a small analytics department. But in order to take things to the next level, we realized we needed dedicated resources, and we needed these teams to work together. now that we have these teams together, they need something to work with, right? So that's where our data lake comes into. Now, basically what our data lake looks like is it's really S3 for storage, and our catalog is an external Hive Metastore. So we use ephemeral clusters, and we can spin them up and we can spin them down, but we don't lose any data as you would on HDFS, right? So that saves us a lot of money. We always keep things in an RDS instance as a Metastore that's running all the time. But we don't really have any limits. S3 scales pretty much indefinitely, and with Kubo we can scale out our clusters indefinitely, which we simply could not do with Redshift. And that serves kind of as the basis for our data pipeline from ingest from the app or from third-party sources, partners, all the way to the end analytics products that we produce. So data engineering handles kind of the piece of getting all the data into one spot. So we call that our raw storage. Basically what that means is we try to get keeping things as raw as possible without any kind of transformation. We make sure everything is in JSON. A lot of the data that we have to begin with is in JSON, so that was kind of a natural choice for us. We also compress the data just to save space, so we're not paying so much for it on S3. Once we have this all in S3 in JSON, it's really easy to just slap external Hive table on top of it. Given that, now anybody has access to the raw data themselves, and they don't need an engineering team to get that for them. We just need to set up the process, define the table, and then our work is done as far as the raw table is concerned. But working with just plain JSON gzip compressed data doesn't really perform well, as you might know. So to help things out, one of the processes we do is reformat that data into something more optimal for use, like work. And we also, in the process of optimizing that, we can run data quality checks to make sure that anything that we're releasing to production passes the sniff test. At the end of that, we make that available through Kubel using Hive or Presto to the entire company, with also the option of loading it into Datamart. So after we use Kubel as a kind of processing engine, and then just load the results, the aggregated tables of things that will be used in things like Looker back into Redshift. All of this orchestration takes place in a tool we use called Airflow. It's also a service provided by Kubel, but we have found it, I think, in data engineering and in iBotalytics to be a great alternative to data pipeline. Cool. So where are we now? So in, let's say, with the first 4 years of Ibotta, with all the data that we collected, now remember, everything has always been stored on S3. I think the highest that we got to was about 20 terabytes. So earlier this year, we started using Kubel. And as you can see, since that, our data processing has risen exponentially. I think in the past 3 months, our processing or the amount of data that we produced has gone up 4x. So now we're pushing over 700 terabytes in just a few months, and totally expect to hit a petabyte this year. And all of this really is due to the fact that we have a data lake to process all this data. And after all that data has been processed, I'm going to let Charlie, Heather talk to you about what we're doing with it.
Thanks, Nate. So next up is the analytics section of this platform, kind of going to talk a little bit about how we're generating all that data that Nate previously displayed. So my name's Charlie, and I sit in the data science team, specifically focusing on feature engineering. So essentially, trying to take this raw data in the data lake and extract generally useful information out of that and turn those into data products that can be used by downstream teams and downstream products. So as a data science team, our mission is to build large-scale machine learning models that extract data or insights outside of this raw data and kind of activate the data. That could be kind of the mission for many different teams at many different companies. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about kind of some of the work we do at Ibotta and how we do it. So Nate spoke a little bit about all the data that we collect. One example of that would be the tens, if not hundreds of thousands of receipt images that we get on a daily basis. And we can use computer vision to turn those receipt images into receipt text, or into item text, basically. But sometimes our users don't like to take great pictures of their receipts. Maybe it's gone through the washing machine twice, and it's all wrinkled, and they're trying to straighten it back out. So the computer vision can sometimes miscategorize or miss many fields on that row of data. So in this instance, we can use things like natural language processing and machine learning to take maybe a string that says like B-A-N, maybe OCR couldn't tell that that was actually banana. We can use machine learning to say, oh, this is most likely a banana. Maybe it also missed the price on that row of data. And we can say, based on this retailer, this time of year, and this geographic location, what is the average price of bananas? Another simple project we could work on is like imputing demographics. So maybe when people register the app, only 30% of them actually fill out their whole demographic profile. But that data is actually super useful in downstream products for things like recommendations or maybe in-app customer segmentation. So we can basically also train models to say, oh, based on the information that we get during registration, maybe some of your prior purchase information, and maybe some geolocation information, we can kind of make predictions on the probability that, you know, user A is male versus female, or user B is Caucasian versus African American or Asian. And then finally, we can do things like category predictions. So obviously, a big piece of Ibotta is trying to serve the right content to the right users. So this would be taking, you know, the hundreds of categories that we have inside of our app, whether that's milk, produce, canned vegetables, et cetera, and making predictions on the likelihood that every user will go out and purchase those categories in maybe the next 90 days, and making those predictions on a daily basis. So how are we actually doing that? We're leveraging Cubel really, really hard. And some of the tools we're using, mostly Python, a little bit of R, but we're using that strictly deployed in Spark, so using PySpark or Spark R. Which is great. It basically, as our data grows, we can scale our models and predictions with that. Similar to what Nate said, for data retrieval and storage, we use Hive. So once the data lake is built, we can read in that data that's in an optimized format, train a model, make predictions on top of that model, and store that back in the Hive metastore. And then finally, we additionally use Airflow, which we're finding to be a great tool. A, because it's got a native integration with Cubel. B, it's got a nice UI. But C, it really allows us to handle dependencies really well. So maybe there's three tasks, like task C, task B, task A, and maybe task B depends on task A. This allows us to say, okay, don't watch task B until task A is completed. And kind of the previous way of us doing that was, okay, we can maybe use data pipeline, or maybe we're just like having a single EC2 machine in the cloud and putting crons on top of each other and crossing our fingers that, you know, job A finishes before job B. So Airflow has been really nice. And then the one last benefit for this is the data science team is actually able to productionize all of our models ourselves. So at many other places, perhaps a data scientist is building a Python library or Python module and throwing that over to engineering and say, hey, optimize this, turn it into C, maybe write it in Java, and hope that it gets this production someday. That's not happening here. We're building these models as soon as, you know, we put in a pull request and it gets approved, we can stick that exact Airflow, or that exact Python function into Airflow, and we'll start deploying that on a daily basis moving forward. So what is kind of the, what does this look like in practice? Like I said, we're trying to build more of a data platform than just a data lake. So our job is to really provide this enhancement layer in between that. And so on the feature engineering team, our goal is to kind of take that raw data and extract generally useful information from it, and then provide that useful information throughout downstream products and give that access to downstream teams as well. So I'll just walk through kind of an example of what a project or a pipeline may look like. So maybe at stage one, we have some pre-processing. And this is what I alluded to earlier. Maybe we have some messy data coming out of computer vision. We want to impute the, you know, the correct prices, quantities, and categories using models that we've built. The next stage would be kind of to roll all that data up to the customer level. So maybe for user A, we'll look at their previous, you know, 90 or years worth of data and calculate things like how many retailers have they been to, what's the total amount of spend, but more importantly, start to capture more predictive fields and kind of in a more sparse format, like what percent of time did you spend at Walmart versus what percent of money did you spend at Target versus what is your share of wallet in the produce category versus the canned goods category. And you know, we can make thousands and thousands or tens of thousands of these kind of different attributes and store those in kind of these complex data types inside of Hive. So kind of once we have these roll-ups ready for machine learning algorithms, maybe we would do something like combine clean transactions, build this transaction roll-up, use some other data, maybe like imputed demographics, to make these category predictions. So for every user, what's their likelihood to go out and buy every single category that we have in our database on a daily basis. So, you know, if a user came out and we see a new receipt from them, we'll categorize all that information that'll flow into the transaction roll-up. We'll make a prediction for that on the next day. And so that can kind of be a standalone product that other teams can use, but it can also flow into downstream products. So on the other side of the data science team, we have our recommendation engine team. So they're building large-scale collaborative filtering engines to basically say, for the rebates we have in the app, how relevant are those to every single offer that we have, or every single user we have in the app? And you can combine kind of those user and offer relevancy scores with kind of some of these users category prediction scores to produce these really powerful in-app recommendations. So that would be something like you might see on Amazon that you might like, or Netflix that you might be interested in this film next. In order to kind of build these type of products, there's obviously some infrastructure and technology along the way, the first of which was Qbol, and this kind of enabled us to work on these type of projects. So many of us on the team were kind of used to working in Python, maybe single EC2 machine, and Redshift. So it was kind of a steep learning curve moving from those systems up into distributed computing, not only from learning the new languages, but more of just a mind shift set in how, you know, how we actually build products. But we were up to speed, you know, within the first month, we were, you know, pulling data from Hive and building products on top of it in Spark. Next is kind of this utility library. This makes our day-to-day work really easily. So the thought behind this is there's things that we interact with on a daily basis, and we don't have to want to be writing redundant functions to do that. So having a utility library that maybe interacts with the Qbol API or helps us do input and output to S3 is really, really helpful for us, and making sure that we have some testing behind that. Again, I alluded to Airflow for our batch deployment process. One additional benefit to this is we can actually have dependencies on our team, but dependencies across teams too. So maybe Nate and his team are pumping data from MySQL into like raw format and then eventually into Hive format. We could have a sensor that says, once we see this, the data that's sitting in the Hive metastore that's ready for analysis, that can actually launch the jobs on our team to kick off an entire pipeline, which is really nice. But you know, we do have some of these larger batch processes that may take a couple hours or even half a day. So over the next quarter or two, we're going to be looking into doing some research and maybe start some development on streaming technologies for that type of data. So finally, we hope we've kind of transformed this data lake into more of a data platform. And when you kind of look at the life cycle of that platform, it kind of serves as the foundation for not only creating a data-driven business, but a data-driven culture. So you can see here, Nate's team is working on taking all of these different data sources, ingesting them, putting inside the Hive Metastore, and then it's kind of our team's responsibility to build products on top of that raw data and add in an additional layer of value. So that data is in S3, we can use, we can leverage Kubel really hard, use Spark, Hive, and Airflow to build the products that sit on top of that, and then we can expose those to different endpoints that are eventually consumed by different users or customers. So maybe we'll put those back into S3 and Hive, but we could also shift those out to different data marts, put those down into Redshift so Looker can speak to them. But this kind of gives us the ability to have a platform that you can do really nice analytics on top of. Heather's going to speak to how we actually get that type of information out to our end users of the data.
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, great. So Nate talked a bit about the data lake and how we got all this massive data, and then Charlie kind of talked about some of the analysis that we did on top of the data. And I'm going to talk about how we basically deploy that information to the masses. And here at Ibotta, the way that we do that is through Looker. Looker is a business intelligence software that allows you to explore, analyze, and then deploy data metrics, business metrics, for basically to the masses. This here is just a quick example of what we call a dashboard. So it's just a collection of different metrics, and it's what our end users see. Each of those metrics, we basically call a tile or a data tile. So at Ibotta, we have a pretty well-developed Looker environment. So we have about 1,500 users, about 580 monthly active users, and about 21,000 monthly visits. We have 355 tables, what they call tables. And tables can be of a couple of types. The first type is sort of your traditional database table that we put some Looker code on top of and then turn the columns into dimensions and measures. And then the second type is what we call a persistent derived table, or PDT. Basically what that is you can think of it as a traditional database view where we write code on top of existing tables to create a different table with different measures and dimensions. And those tables power about 145 dashboards. 25 of those dashboards, around 25, are for our external clients. And at this point, Looker talks to Redshift in our environment. So that's kind of an idea of our Looker landscape, but I want to talk a little bit about the benefits that we get from using Looker, both internal as well as external benefits. So first for external, the dashboards we provide our clients allow them to ensure that they're reaching the right customers at the right time, but also allows them to hone the customers that they're trying to reach. As Nate talked about earlier, it used to be that there were some Ibotta employees that spent hours a week manually collecting metrics, putting them in Excel, and sending them to clients. That's just not possible anymore with the sheer volume of partners that we have. It even took a ton of time back then. But now with our Looker dashboards, when we get a new partner, we can put some inputs in for their particular cases, and then they have their own dashboard that they can go look at. They can refresh it anytime they want, and it has a standard set of metrics for them to see how their campaign is running, for example. And these dashboards are standard. So we've developed this suite of dashboards once, and then for each partner, we can just include the information that's relevant for them, and then ship it off, and they have it available. It takes minimal time to deploy that. And in fact, John over there in the back has, in the last couple of weeks, completely automated this process. So when we get new partners, it's just a click of a button and it automatically sends it out. It was a ton of work for him, but it saved hours and hours of time. Internally, and I bought one of our core values is transparency. And what this means in one way is that employees at all levels of the organization have insight to what's going on at the company as a whole. They know what the company's goals are, but more importantly, they know how we're performing against those goals. With Looker, we're able to provide dashboards that show these KPIs, so anybody at any time can go see how the company is performing. There's no, let's wait till the metric is good and then share it with the company. It's anytime we want to go see, it's there for everybody. It also means that everybody's looking at the same metric. There's no change for, well, our department wants to see it this way and our department wants to see it this way. No, this is how we're doing and everybody's going to see it this way. The dashboard also enables us to not just ship our internal customers numbers and say, well, go figure it out and have fun with that. We actually present, and you saw in the dashboard example, really great graphics so they can quickly see whatever metric they're trying to measure and how it's doing. And it provides with actionable knowledge, something that they can take and go do something with. And then once they do something with it, they can come back and see, well, how did our action affect these same metrics? Not only does Looker provide the functionality of these kind of canned, pre-created dashboards that are done by my team, it also allows for any individual user to go and basically create their own information view. So we've provided tables with mentions, dimensions and measures. They can go into the Looker UI and actually pull those dimensions and measures that are interesting for them. So our team isn't really bogged down with requests of, oh, I think it would be interesting to look at this. Teams can just go do it, and that allows for very self-sufficient teams. Now all three of these bullet points combined allow for analytics to be a foundation at every department here. We're a data-driven organization, and so everybody has access to the raw data. It's not the domain of just the engineering or just the analytics department, but every employee at Ibotta. Which means that we all have the ability and thus responsibility to make data-driven decisions. There's no, well, I feel like this would be a good thing, or have a gut feeling that I think this will work, but you have data to back it up. And then you have data to back up if it did or if it didn't work. So up to this point, we've had Looker on Redshift, and it has served us really well. But as our client teams continue to grow, and their questions continue to grow, and really more importantly, the sophistication of their questions continue to grow, we're starting to outgrow this implementation. Some of the issues we're running into is that the dashboards are just taking a long time to load. There's a lot of data, a lot of dashboards, and it all just kind of bogs down the system. And if you think of the PDTs that I mentioned earlier, since the questions are more sophisticated, we do actually have to create more of these PDTs. The data just isn't in the tables natively. And with that, we're just having a huge explosion of these PDTs, which every time one of these runs on a particular cadence, it puts a load on our resources. And that's just obviously increasing the need for more resources and really just becoming unsustainable. And finally, the sheer number of dashboards is just getting difficult to manage. So you can imagine with 145 dashboards, there is definitely duplication of data out there. Also, it's hard to know what data is where, what metric is in what dashboard, and even on our team, and we are the kind of stewards of these dashboards, we don't always know what data is where. We have to go do a manual search, and that all takes time. Finally, as we've included more and more data, we maybe not haven't necessarily provided any more actionable knowledge, but just more data for the sake of data. And we've actually maybe decreased clarity in some cases. And so we're going to be doing a complete Looker redesign from end to end. Now this is a huge project for our team, and it's going to, we're just really in the planning stages of it. But what we hope is at the end we'll have a more streamlined Looker, but at the same time our internal customers will actually have better access to more data. And the way that we're going to do this is we're going to move all of our ETL jobs into Hive. And then in doing so, we're going to create some very wide tables. So for a given measure, we're going to have maybe 100 different dimensions. So a customer row will have all the information about that particular customer. And then we're going to use Presto on Looker to query that data. And since those expensive joins will have already been done with these wide tables, it'll return the data much quicker, decreasing the time to load the dashboards. And then over on the UI side, we're actually going to decrease the number of dashboards. We're going to obviously continue to do our KPI dashboards. As I mentioned before, we want to keep that transparency and consistency. We'll probably still have some dashboards for SLT reporting. But then, because of the wide table, our internal customers are going to have access to a lot more data, and they're going to be able to, it's going to be more raw data, so they're going to be able to have more ability to slice and dice that data as appropriate for them. So we won't need to, if they want to see data a certain way, it's not going to have to be a request to our team to go do the pull. They'll be able to do it themselves. And then finally, we're going to upgrade to Looker 5, and we're going to be able to use all of the new features that come with that version.
Thanks, Heather. Thanks, Charlie. So I just want to wrap things up, point out some things I hope you can take away from this talk, things will be done. So since we instituted the data lake and the data team, we've been able to prove a 7% lift in revenue inside the app using our A/B testing framework. And guess where that framework lives? Nowadays, you know, the data team doesn't have any scaling issues. We're not constantly fighting with Redshift in order to do more. Still supporting it, but a lot of the burden has gone away when it comes to scaling out. We've also had a chance to tackle some really challenging and really interesting problems, like Charlie was talking about. Great cross-team collaboration. A lot of these changes weren't just about a shift in technology or infrastructure. It's about setting up a real data team. And it's not an us versus them, it's something that we work together every day. And it's something that is a benefit for me personally. A huge AWS bill, as you probably saw with how much our data has grown. But with that though, we're scaling smarter with Keybolt. So in scaling, we're gonna need more storage and we're gonna need more compute, but by going through Keybolt, we get a lot of the automation from them. We get a lot of the support. That's worth it. So that's about it for the presentation piece. I think we have some time for some Q&A. So who has the first question? Yeah. Oh yeah. We're hiring.
We are hiring data scientists, platform engineers, data engineers. If you want to work on cool problems, come talk to one of us after this. Absolutely.
On my way.
Hey guys, quick question. From inception to completion, how long did it take to completely transfer from the data warehouse all the way over?
Maybe about 8 months. I consider it like it's never really done, but version one, I think we're pretty much there. There's still some things we need to do, but yeah.
Less than a year?
Less than a year, yeah, totally.
All right, well, I can add to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, even within the first month of getting onboarded with Keybolt, we didn't have a full infrastructure in place, but we were able to actually start building products on the data science team, maybe not in the most optimal process, but just shoving data up to S3 and running models with Hive and Spark. That was within the first month that we onboarded with Keybolt.
So which process are you following? To automate your current dashboards in Looker?
It's a huge Python script, right, John?
Yes.
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
What process are you following to automate the automatic dashboard creation?
Oh, sure. So a lot of that data lives in MySQL, and we're using an engine that we built in Python to grab that data out of MySQL, hit the Looker API, and build out their access filters and define what they have access to within Looker. And that's all done through Python. Does that answer your question?
Thanks, John.
So regarding PySpark, I know that there are some limitations to the Spark API that come along with using PySpark as opposed to Scala. And so I assume that you're just using Spark Submit to submit to a cluster that Kubel, you know, runs. Have you run into any of those limitations? Are there any pain points with that, or is this something that you haven't considered yet?
So we do have a couple people on the team that are using the Scala implementation, especially more on the platform engineering side. From the data science perspective, we haven't really run into any major issues with PySpark. It suits us really well since PySpark has a ton of good machine learning libraries, and even we're able to do some non-distributed training and then deploy those models with Python. So maybe we'll create an sklearn pipeline, train that in a non-distributed fashion, and then you could kind of distribute that model object across every single one of the executors to make predictions at a much larger scale. So in terms of issues that we're having with PySpark, no, that's not an issue for us, and we're not really looking to move away from Python into Scala for the majority of our use cases. Yeah, that's a good question. So why would you not want to distribute the learning of a machine learning algorithm? We found that, you know, if you use things like MLlib as compared to sklearn, you'll actually get much higher. Like, typically, we don't need to train models on more than maybe, you know, a quarter or a half a million observations. And we've seen much better results when training models in a non-distributed fashion. The benefit of that kind of is you can have one single object stored in S3, and then we're actually making let's say you train on half a million observations, but you want to make predictions on a billion rows, you can just load that object that's sitting in S3, distribute that to all the executors that you have, and pipe data through it. I think that's just from past experience. We've seen quite a significant dip in actually our evaluation metrics when we use a Spark ML.
Hey guys, great job. You mentioned early on you have on your roadmap considering some use of the real-time streaming analytics. Without disclosing too much of your kind of private plan, so to speak, give me a little picture, if you can, of just what a use case there at Ibotta looked like for the use of real-time data.
Yeah, I may not be the best person to describe this, but let's say that we have a ton of sort of data in a data store, maybe more like a key value data store like DynamoDB, and we want that data accessible for us in Hive, maybe rather than unloading that entire data table from Dynamo into Hive, maybe just like having a Spark streaming stream that is able just to stream the diffs into that new table rather than making a snapshot on a daily basis. I don't know if that answers your question, but I think that's more.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of our clients are running ad campaigns. Now, do you want to wait till tomorrow to see results, or do you want to start seeing them right now?
Oh yeah, a big use case for us on the data science team could be like real-time recommendations. So let's say that you go into the app in the beginning of the day, you want to see like what's in the app and maybe unlock a couple rebates, but you actually don't go shopping until later in the day. Rather than making recommendations on a daily basis, we would like to take the most up-to-date information that we can and personalize the app based on your latest information. And that is very, very important, especially if you're a new user. So let's say you just opened the app, and you maybe, you know, you kind of go through, there's different onboarding flows compared to like what persona you may go into, and being able to personalize that in real time could be a big advantage. We think that there could be some fruitful beginnings there.
So I guess piggybacking on that a little bit, are you mostly doing kind of batch learning right now, and so you don't really have an emphasis on online learning models as it stands?
Yeah, so the nature of the stuff that we're doing right now works really well for batch. Like we typically, like we gather data on a daily basis, and we can kind of make the most up-to-date predictions the next day. That works really well for the data science team currently. Again, we only really started building these type of processes 6 to 8 months ago. I think there most likely is a use case for streaming in the future, but that's kind of what I alluded to, is kind of probably starting the more research phase over the next quarter or two, and then seeing how that might fit into production in 2018.
What else?
Cool, well, it sounds like we have the fireside chat up next. And so if there's any questions that you guys think of, we can maybe discuss during that.
Thanks. If we want to use this as sort of a launching off point for more questions, if you have anything, so please try to make this interactive, and we'll just, you're looking for something.
No, it's good. I was seeing if there's something in the microphone.
So if you have questions, just jump on in. So let's just get started. I think we want to start with just talking, just going around the list of everybody. Just please introduce yourself and what we want to do. What we want to say, quickly introduce yourself, who you work for, and how you use big data, any highlights on what you've learned along the way. So you're making a face like that's a brand new question, which is great because now we're going to get a great answer.
That's a broad question, but
thank you.
My name is Ron White. I am the VP of Engineering here at our host, Ibotta. I've been with the company about 4 years, and I was the original noob who set up Redshift many years ago. Now, kind of overseeing much of this crew here. I do wonder, where is the fireside? Where is the fireside?
Do you really want me to start a fire? I'll do it. Do you really want me to?
No fires, please.
I'm Heather Trujillo, and I work for the business analytics team here at Ibotta, specifically on the business intelligence team, Team Looker. Oh, I've been here for 5 months, and what have I learned? So much. But here at Ibotta, I think what I've learned the most is what a great partnership we have between our customers and our data teams. We all work together, and there's no kind of us-them environment, and that's kind of helped us to get to where we are now.
I'm Nate McIntyre. I'm a data engineering lead here at Ibotta. I started back in March. What have I learned? Scaling this stuff out, it's more about technology. I'm an engineer, but I tend to think the technological piece is really simple. It's bringing people along with that technology, which is a difficult piece that I overlooked at first, but it's something I've learned.
This is a great story, right? These Ibotta guys, they're doing such great stuff. My name is Ben Robichek. I'm a solutions architect for Qubal, that we've been talking about quite a bit here. And I just joined the company about a month ago. Prior to that, I was actually working for a customer company of Qubal's, actually a different one. And as an engineering manager and an engineer and architect. And so I've been doing, and I did that for 15 years before this. So I really, really have enjoyed working for Qubal for the last month. And a couple of things that I've learned in kind of going back into my career is this data lake stuff is actually really important. It's important because without being enabled, without being empowered with the data, it's very hard to actually do anything. It's It's hard to be feature focused. That people get really, really bogged down with operations and with projects tied to operationalizing the data. So the big thing that I've taken away has really just been more around flipping the model such that teams can be focused on features, like these guys are here today, and instead of so much operations.
Thanks. My name is Charlie Frazier. I sit on the data science team, specifically the feature engineering team. I was one of the first analysts here at Ibotta, so I've kind of learned everything that I do know here at Ibotta, so from Python to SQL and now to the new big data tools. And I think the biggest learning for me is that a lot of companies have a lot of data, but they have trouble finding the value inside of that data. So over the last 8 months, we've kind of really seen things come together. And as Nate alluded to, kind of the combination of the work that we do on the feature engineering team, leveraging the work on the recommendations team, like we launched our first A/B test and saw, you know, a 7% lift in revenue inside of our app, and that's huge value that's paying, you know, well worth the AWS bills that we're paying. So that's a little bit about me.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm Lucas Tillelsen. I'm the VP of Professional Services at Lookout. And we're out of Santa Cruz, but I'm in Boulder, so close by. And about 5 years ago, I was across the street here at Craftsy, and we were celebrating our 4-node Redshift cluster. And I was super excited. And we celebrated our 8-node cluster, and at 12 nodes, we started to get worried. I have since helped a couple of companies like Uber or Snapchat or Cigna, like a couple of the companies that have some massive data opportunities. And joined, like Looker is actually what I got into place at Craftsy for us to be able to switch databases without having to switch out the front end, right? The visualizations and the portals that we have for our customers or vendors to access and see how things are performing. So I got really passionate about that data model, like Looker in between, to make that possible, to have flexible backends. And since then, joined Looker. So excited to be here.
Cool. I have a couple questions. We can just get started. If anybody has anything they want to interrupt with, please do. But actually, this one was largely for John, but he's not there. So Nathan. Nope, Nathan gets it. sorry. We were talking earlier about this anyway, but separating compute and storage. And I think you touched a little bit about it on your presentation as well. But why has that been a big deal to you? And you know, what has it really enabled you to do?
Yeah, it's almost something I take for granted now, but yeah, it makes a big difference with scaling. That is like the main reason that we want to move away from Redshift as the data warehouse. We have found the need at least to, you know, scale storage much quicker than we have compute, and so why pay for both when we only need to increase one? The other reason for separating it too, this is something else I take for granted, is the ephemeral clusters that we get from Qbol, right? So we're not processing things 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So there's no real reason to keep those compute resources up and pay for them, right? So by separating those, we can power down the cluster. We don't lose anything.
Cool. Ben, do you have anything to add to that? Switching what?
How much did you save by switching from Redshift to, you know, Qbol?
Just an engineer.
It's been a while since I did this calculation, but we were initially looking to roll out the data lake. I calculated it based upon storage on S3 versus the SOT. Equivalent size we would need Redshift. It was like about 1/50th of the cost. Of course, we've still got a Redshift cluster running, so we're still paying for that. But logistically, it's big savings.
But if I remember right, like you can't spin up Redshift up and down like you can't Qbol, right?
No, not at all.
I didn't know. I'm sorry.
It's there. It's not there. The bigger it gets, the longer it takes to resize, the longer amount of time you're in a read-only degraded state. It gets tougher to work with the bigger you get.
So you're kind of committed to it there, where with Kubel or all that you can kind of split up right now.
Yes.
Does
Kubel
spin up the Kafka clusters or screen?
Repeat your question on the mic.
Does Kubel spin up the Kafka clusters or screen?
Kubel currently does not support Kafka directly. So the streaming support that we have today is like with Spark Streaming, where you can attach to a Kafka cluster and stream data through your application and perform analytics or ETL on that data. We're not.
You have to do your own Kafka cluster.
Yes. But can I add, so on the storage versus compute thing, there's the cost side of things, which is really compelling. There's also another way to look at this too, which is around performance. People often think, wow, I'm putting my data into the cloud, so and it's not node local as it is on my Hadoop cluster. And a lot of customers, and rightly so, are concerned about performance. What I will say though is that in the last 5 years or so, columnar formats have come a long way. So formats like Parquet and ORC and Snappy Compression, combining those together, has made tremendous improvements to what you can do in pulling your data out of S3. Just a real quick, just for people that might not understand what that means, when you store your data columnar, you're storing all of your columns like in columns of data sequentially. It means that if you want to, let's say, access gender, like the gender field, that you can seek to a particular point of a file and read just a section of it. And so if your queries, and this is where Heather was mentioning about having really, really wide tables, the reason you do that is because most queries don't need 100 dimensions. They only need four or five or six. And that's smaller portions of the file. And by doing so, you dramatically cut down on the amount of I/O that you're pulling across the wire. So if you're using CSV or JSON, you're not getting any of those benefits. But if you're using columnar, you're getting those benefits, and it's tremendous. And so I guess the using S3 as a storage backend really does pay off when you're using columnar formats beyond the initial ETL. And it's what really makes this whole story sort of pay off for customers that, of course, sort of do this separation of storage and compute, and still actually put Presto and even Looker on top of data that's actually sitting in S3 without any caching along the way, and still make it useful for customers.
Thanks. Lucas, I have you down as somebody to make a comment. What do you got?
Oh.
I thought you might be a little surprised, but I saw your name here, so whatever.
Okay, my comments on separating storage and compute?
Okay. You're here, so.
Okay. There we go.
You're welcome to pass. You're welcome to say pass.
No, I mean, I think it's, we have seen that problem now a lot of times where it's like the data just grows with the company, right? And all of a sudden, like you're paying for compute that you may not need, or vice versa, right? You need more compute and you don't need all that storage. So I think separating it just totally makes sense. And I think that's where the majority of the market is going. A lot of the data offerings is going on. Yeah.
Totally had a good answer.
Yeah, that wasn't very fun.
Yeah.
There you go.
So, yeah. I was actually just curious, does Ibotta use Parquet? Or,
okay.
Yeah.
Well,
thank you.
The
data science team uses Parquet, the data engineering team uses Orc.
I will tell you, I don't know of like any team that uses all of the same data format, which is very strange. But
they're both good.
Yeah, they're both very good.
Parquet.
Yes, I think it's a bit of a religious battle.
Yeah.
So whatever. This is sort of an open-ended question to whoever wants to answer, but there's a term data lake that comes out a lot, and I don't know if a lot of people know what it means, including myself. But what does it mean to you, and how is it helping with what you're doing?
I guess I'll take the first whack at this one. So it means a lot of different things. For me, some of the key points are having a centralized place for all your data, so you're not accessing this database or another one.
using different types of SQL, whether it's Hive or standard SQL, or you have to write custom jobs to access the data. It's all in one place. Another key component means that the raw data is always available to you. You're not seeing some end product that maybe has been rolled out or munched in some way. You always have access to that raw data. And then there's a lot of things that I think come with that. There's the data piece and the governance piece, cataloging of data. I think that is the data lake, but yeah.
Ron, you're nodding your head crazily at the whole idea of having all the raw data.
Yeah, I concur with what Nathan said. It really is all about having the raw data, but very accessible, so you can get to whatever answer.
Is that mostly for looking up new answers or recovering in case of an issue or
both,
all of the above?
All of the above, but really the option and opportunity to answer questions you may not know you need to ask in the future.
If you don't mind, I'll chime in from the peanut gallery. one of the nice things about having a data lake is your data is not only in one place, but it's accessible by all the teams almost immediately. So you're not writing your data through Redshift and MySQL and having to transport data around. It really helps unify the teams and get them working in concert even faster.
From a reporting standpoint, it's great that we can have data go back as far as we need it to go. We sometimes get questions of what was happening 2 years ago, and with the data, like, we don't have to worry about, oh, well, that data is archived somewhere and it's impossible to get it back. It's there.
One big thing for us is the idea of write once, kind of read anywhere. So once the data is sitting in S3 or Hive, we can use Spark on top of that, Hive on top of that, Presto on top of that, whatever we see fit. And our team, that's especially powerful because we utilize all three of those technologies.
Lucas, sort of paraphrasing the question a bit, but how do you deal with access controls for accessing the data in the data lake?
Yeah, that's a little bit paraphrasing it. The question I had in mind was around...
I'm sorry, I can ask the question the way you want me to if you want to.
So the question, actually, we had the question...
I'm going to go back and ask the question. The question is, we talked about the value of the data lake. How do you prevent that only people in the know can use it?
Yeah,
I take that as access control, but whatever, go ahead.
No, access control is a good one, too, along the lines. What I was more thinking in terms of was the very transparent company, given like Abora here, right, where it's really not, I mean, some companies where they're like, let's say a certain company, they want to go public, right, that's a question. There's something you need to have in place in order to do that, and not have insider trading happening. And there are other reasons, right, you may be in healthcare and you need to cut down on data lake access. That's really important, and along the lines of that, how do you get the value out of it really quickly for your end users, right? The data science guys, they love the data lake. Most people in the analytics world, they do, but then there's also the true end user, right? Like the, I don't know, head of marketing, right? And they may not know really why they should care about the data lake. And I think that's where, what I mentioned earlier, the data, it's important to have this quick data model that you can put in between, so people can, as I said earlier, on the dashboard you have this little red tile and you want to know why it's red, or like the dashboard shows you the what is going on, but in order to see the why, you want to be able to drill down and go to the raw data, and that's where that's why I'm so excited about having, like, that data model in Looker, right, like where you can drill down, you can go to the raw data, you can explore, you can figure out why it's happening. Sometimes your data engineering team is already on top of it, it has it fully modeled out, and sometimes you can use and prototype it first in your BI tool of choice.
Yeah, I totally did not paraphrase that right. That's a much better answer.
Yeah, and then you can, at the same time with that, right, you can put access filters and whatnot on all kinds of layers if you need to. But, you know, luckily there's tons of cool companies out there that want their people to explore everything.
Withdrawn. Actually, this next one's interesting. I think Nathan and I talked about this a little bit too, but
How do you go from people that have been using things like Redshift and all, it's kind of feels good enough to them to start using some of the big data technologies to sort of, you know, it's not going to be an immediate benefit, but there's going to be benefit pretty quickly, and they're going to, you know, leapfrog where they're at right now in a while. How do you get them to sort of buy into that?
I'll go first. Yeah.
So I've only been on a month, but I have worked with quite a few customers already, and for most of the companies that we see, they're feeling pain. They're feeling pain in some way. They're having problems with access or with just slowness of projects getting done, or just general confusion about what I have access to or what I don't. I guess the approach that we take and we think works really, really well is really to be use case focused. So it's not, I think when you look at on-prem or you look at bigger installations like Redshift, you're really trying to be the biggest hammer. You got to build a big hammer and put that in place so that you can solve, you know, whack all the nails. And in cloud, it's just not that way. The use of the data lake is the most efficient use of storage that I think we know about. And then your clusters, your compute can be tuned to your use case. And so the way that I think, you know, a lot of customers start is with a pain, and then the solution is, well, let's not just re-architect everything. Let's pick a use case because we can be efficient at that. The data lake architecture and the separation of storage and compute enables you to pick and choose use cases without necessarily just, you know, torching the farm. And so that's a really powerful way, I think, to start to leverage data lake architectures and you know, Kubel or just ephemeral clusters in general, to start to extract value out of your data.
Heather, you're nodding like crazy.
Yeah. I can speak from the perspective of a person that did not want to shift from Redshift. So one of the things that I think made a huge difference here was having folks like Charlie and Nate who basically evangelized using these different tools. They're passionate about it, they know it well, but more than, also they're willing to teach the rest of us. They've spent a lot of time answering questions in the Slack channel, meeting with us individually, and I think that is a huge benefit. If you have people that are willing to help, it just seems less scary knowing that if you don't have all the answers right away, there's somebody that will have many of them. And I know the folks at Kubel also have been super helpful in making our transition.
From my perspective, my level is actually incredibly easy. when you've got good leadership, our CTO, he went to reInvent last year, and there was a lot of talk about the data lake. And he came back, and he knew we had a lot of data that we just didn't really know what to do with, and we're just dropping on the floor, literally. Just setting aside, not making any use of. And he said to me, we need this thing, a data lake. We need a data lake. We need to move forward with that. And I went and built out a team to go build that, and yeah, I had that mandate to go, we know we need this, and we've made great use of it with between Charlie's team, Heather's work, Nate putting it together, and there was no doubt at any time.
The next question I have is around going from a prototype to a production system. Like one of that, this actually came up in the, when we were talking about this before, but it seems like it's super easy in things like Kubel and all to play with an idea and come up with something good. And like, how do you transition that into a production system? And Nathan's nodding his head. What to say about that?
I'm nodding my head thinking Charlie's great for answering this
question. I meant Charlie.
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think the biggest thing for us is airflow. I think that is the biggest piece for us here. So we're able kind of do our scratch work all in Kubel, maybe like on some sort of, since you can spin up clusters very easily in Kubel, we could have a dev cluster and a prod cluster, or a dev backfill cluster or a prod backfill cluster. So we can do all of our scratch work
in our own databases inside of Kubel, not quite using our own clusters yet, but like sharing clusters among the team. So we're able to basically do a bunch of scratch work, test the whole pipeline in staging, and then when we're comfortable with some sort of process that we're ready to move to production, it's as easy as wrapping that entire pipeline inside of a pipeline inside of a Python function, and then wrapping that Python function inside of a Python operator, and now that is a task inside of Airflow. One challenge that we're kind of working with right now is how do we come up with a staging Airflow instance? So rather than just going from here's this thing, how do we just put it right into production? We would like to get to a world where we have a staging Airflow instance, so when we put something into production, it's not running through, you know, the 100 or one, you know, couple hundred jobs that we have. It would be great to build a DAG that just has the process that we're looking to get into production and maybe what those depend on. Stage it for a few days, make sure everything works, and then put that into the actual prod. So we kind of have like true dev, dev prod, and hopefully eventually have, you know, real prod, if that makes sense.
It does, but it sounds like for you, largely the whole Airflow component's been very helpful for moving from development to production.
Yeah, Airflow's great. And it's really flexible too. You don't have to go all in on Airflow and say we're only doing things with Airflow. The way our team uses it is basically we develop everything in Python. We can turn a Python function directly into a Python operator in Airflow and deploy that way. So maybe a new technology comes out that's better than Airflow, or we decide for some reasons Airflow doesn't have a specific functionality that we need. We don't have a huge amount of tech debt. We still have all of these Python modules that we're able to easily transfer over to maybe a different job scheduling platform.
I have three more questions here. Are we still doing good on time?
I was going to add one more thing to that.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I mean, we have 3.5 questions left. Is he going to finish answering this one?
So what I would say along the lines, it's the development tests prod cycle for every company is extremely different. For most people though, it's a function of mitigating risk, and so the more you're able to consider things like A/B testing or blue-green deployments or things like that, where you have a lot more control around the exposure of data and features and learnings and all those things, the faster you're able to get things turned around, because by the nature of seeing an A/B, you're able to get really, really early warning feedback about what's going on. So I think, you know, Charlie explained how he's kind of using Kubel for that and Airflow, but I would say from a data perspective and just from an architecture perspective, the most successful teams that I've seen so far around that are using data machine learning are really taking A/B testing to heart.
Cool, thank you.
Yes. Okay.
So Lucas, I was just gonna ask, have you seen companies succeed in getting businesses users to use big data? Of getting business users to use big data.
Yeah, that comes back to the idea of like starting with a dashboard that's performant and then being able to drill and be not lost, right? Like I think the challenge with a data lake potentially is like where does a business user that doesn't know all about it go? And so having a fairly curated experience where they can go and explore and ask questions themselves, like questions that may not even, you know, the data engineering team may not have thought of yet, or the analyst team may not have thought of. I think that's really, really fantastic where they really see the value and are willing to invest more into data infrastructure if they really get that. Like I think, you know, Ibotta's in a really lucky space compared to some other companies that I'm seeing where you really have leadership bought in on like, we are investing in this and we want to do this, right? We have the goals literally on the wall, which is amazing. I don't see that very often, right? Like lots of people in the data space and companies, they really have to, like companies say they want to be data driven, but to really get there, like they have to push. And I think getting executives, non-naturally data people to be having a very quick access to the questions they want to answer, I think that's really key.
And Heather, you're responsible for the dashboards and a lot of the data. Do you find this to be helpful when you get in front of the business users?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, we have
only lean on our team when really more in-depth information is needed or when they want to disseminate that information. It allows for a small business intelligence team because we don't have analysts going off on wild goose chases of, oh, this person wants to know what this is just for their own.
Yeah, just one thing to add there, just because you have a data lake doesn't mean that's your only source of data. For instance, especially when it comes to reporting, we may be able to give access to the data lake to some users in Looker, but maybe on the back end, we're able to roll up these aggregate tables in batch using Hive or Spark, and then put those down into something like Redshift or even more transactional like MySQL that can be very performant in that setting. So just because you have a data lake doesn't mean you don't have any other data marts. It's kind of, I think, at Ibotta, we think about it as like the right tool or the right database for the right job. So we can have the data lake and batch processes doing the heavy lifting, but put that in kind of a more performant or user-friendly database before it's delivered to the end consumer.
Do you consider like your data lake more of the system of record for everything, though? Just like at the base of it, and then you spin other things off of it?
Nate can probably answer this better, but a large reason why we built the data lake was to have like a centralized source of truth for our data. Previously, we have many different data sources living in many different places, and if you have dashboards built by different people or different teams, you might have different metrics that are driving different decisions across the company, which can be very detrimental.
And to that performance, or like right tool for the right, whatever you said, that was really good. having super performant dashboards, maybe running on Postgres, right, and then being able to drill down and jump over to Presto or something, I think that's really cool. Where for us, like 20 seconds performance is fine, right, on a query. For some business users, that's probably not okay. So I think that's what I've seen too, where you want to be able to jump between data sources and databases.
Cool. Thanks. I think we touched on this a little bit already, but machine learning at Ibotta, what are you doing and what's sort of been the interesting areas for the products for machine learning?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of enabled us to build products that completely transform the company. I think we kind of officially started the data science team at the beginning of this year, and we're already up past 12 people on that team, so obviously heavy emphasis on machine learning and data science, and it's almost paramount to reach some of the goals that we've set for the company. It's almost involved in every single product that we build these days. I think the biggest mind shift was kind of going from like one-to-one deterministic to a more probabilistic nature. So what is the probability that this may happen in the future? The kind of essence of data science or machine learning problems is they're never fully solvable. So like, how do you get to that 80% solution in the quickest amount of time and then move on to the next product that you might be able to add more value with? So I talked a bit about it before, but having predicted values for everything that we might find useful. So what's a user's demographics? How likely are they to purchase every single brand on every single day? The same thing for like every single product category, kind of building that data enhancement layer and then building products on top of that, like the recommendation system. A huge push for Ibotta is one-to-one personalization inside of the app, and that's not possible without machine learning. I guess one of the challenges with that is you can see the data growth at Ibotta, and that's largely due to some of the work that we're doing. And so how do you take kind of the output of some of these machine learning models? Maybe you have billions and billions of recommendation scores across different A/B tests, and how do you actually serve those inside of the app? And so those are some of the scaling challenges that we're working with now.
Cool, thank you. Just to wrap it up, can we go around the folks that appear? What's one big challenge and one big sort of obstacle you've run into, please be honest, around big data that you incorporating into what you're doing? But like, what's one learning that somebody can take away from what you've done and hopefully not make the same mistake?
Yeah, so this one is, I've seen this now a bunch of times, and I was surprised by it. So it's, I don't know if this is shared by people here, but I think one of the challenges that I've seen in the data space is that we, and I don't feel like you need to be included in that we, don't think of ourselves as product managers per se sometimes, like especially on the analytics front maybe. So not presenting a roadmap of how we get there. Like we have a vision of we want to be data driven, but how are we going to get there and what will be achieved when, and make sure all the stakeholders are informed of when things will happen and delays. And I don't know, all these classic product things I think are sometimes missing in the data space, and I think it's an important mind shift, because it is nobody will have the perfect data platform stack tomorrow. It's a journey to get there. It's probably never ending, as we talked about earlier. And so I think that's just super important that if you are in charge, if you are part of a team, just become a product owner to some extent and own BI, own data that way.
Yeah, I think for our team, I'm going to go back to kind of a point that Nate made, was not scaling the technologies or the tools that we're using, but really scaling the teams. And how do you scale the different teams at the right pace, at the right time? So for instance, where there was no data science team, there was no data lake, there was no data engineering team at the beginning of the year for our team, and we've probably grown the data science team much more aggressively than the data engineering team. So like their backlog is pretty big, so it can kind of figure out like how do those two teams interact, and on the hiring front, like before we had any of these processes in place, it was hard to find data scientists and data engineers that wanted to come work here, but kind of now that we have the ball rolling, people are really excited to come work on really challenging problems at scale and kind of work from them from the bottom up. They don't have to come into a company working with a bunch of tech debt and working around that. We're kind of building everything from start to finish the way that we think is best, and getting to use the tools that we think are best for the job. We're not really restricted on how we approach a problem or what tools we need to do to succeed on that project.
P.S. You're hiring.
P.S. We are hiring platform engineers, data scientists, data analysts,
mobile
engineers, Android engineers.
If you're looking for a job, come talk to us.
Yeah, if you like data, come talk to us afterwards. Or apps.
Just go talk to us.
2 years ago, I was a pretty cocky engineer, who ran a 10-person team that was chartered with building a data lake and making it available. And I built it myself, pretty much. And with the help of my team. And about a month later, one of my team members comes and says, hey, there's these Kubel guys. They do everything we do, and they do it really, really well. And so I really had to sort of eat crow on that by a lot of people. And it wasn't, that part wasn't really fun. That's a sad thing story. But what I would say is that this big data stuff is really hard. It's like, there's no doubt about it. Like, especially on, like, most people kind of understand what S3 does, and there's, you know, it's pretty well documented. But when it comes to the clusters and the compute side of this, of the equation, when you include machine learning and ETL and Spark and Hive and distributed processing and all these different things, it's freaking hard. There's a lot to consider. And so I think we signed up for Kubel right away. It wasn't that, I mean, honestly, we would have probably signed up for any company that was doing this kind of stuff because it was so much better than what we had built internally. And so it's not to say you should marginalize your own internal operations, but if you can really focus your operations on what's really core to you, then it's a better use of your time and effort. So it's something that was very humbling for me, and I'm sure it's humbling for a lot of people that end up spending a lot of time re-architecting systems. And I know a lot of people, a lot of senior engineers, there's just no getting away from it. You are re-architected systems. Like, I think there are certainly room for partners to help with that, especially on the operations front. So I know it fits in with what Kubel's doing, but it just, that's why I joined the company, because I love having to solve this operation stuff. So anyway, that's it. Thanks.
I think you can't leave people behind. I think of big data, I think the technical challenge, it's solvable these days, right? People know what the solution is, but not everyone fully embraces change, and you can't just migrate a system from underneath people and expect them just to jump on board. So I think that's something I've learned. You have to account for that. You have to make yourself available. Yeah, and it takes work, and it's not just a technical migration, it's an organizational one.
For me, I think it's letting perfect be the enemy of good. This is really tough stuff, like Ben said, and you're probably not going to get it right first, but that doesn't mean you don't move forward. I mean, you move forward with the pieces that you know and do the best you can and iterate off of that, and eventually you have the solution you need. But just taking the step forward in that journey, and something is better than nothing, I think, in a lot of cases.
I would say, you know, in quoting Field of Dreams, which is not necessarily my favorite movies, but actually, I've only seen it once, I think. But build it and they will come. We put some data together, made it relatively accessible in Redshift, exposed it through Looker, and I had no idea the amount that people would access this and dig into it, dive in and find great information, give us great guidance into where to go as a company. We went forward from there and started building this data lake, put things into Hive. Made data accessible through Kubel, and the demand was insatiable. And did I mention we're hiring data engineers?
I'm not sure anybody has.
We are hiring data engineers. No,
that's a surprise, but anyway.
But you have the data, you make it accessible, and there will be great demand. But at the same time, I don't want to discredit what the analytics side of the house has done. There are companies out there with big data, lots of data, and they don't know what to do with it. And we have a great, phenomenal team that does know what to do with it and are doing great things with it. So just get the data, put it in an accessible place, and build a team that knows how to use it.
Great. Thank you all. Thank you for your time. And if anybody has any questions, we can turn it over there. But if not, thank you all.